Okay, now from academia, we have Dr. Timothy Welsh. Dr. Timothy is a co-director of the Future Cities Research Hub up at the University of Auckland. And the hub is part, interestingly, part of the Faculty of Creative Arts and Industries at the University of Auckland, which of course suggests that the future cities need to be imagined before they can be built. So over to you, Timothy.
Okay, well, first of all, not to burst your bubble, but I don't have the answers of how we get to where we need to be in 2015, but I have some ideas of the things we might do that'll push us towards that direction. And so, and the other thing I'll say is I'm gonna stay on script tonight so I don't run out of time and for other reasons, but so Auckland is a pretty amazing city to me. It's a city of diverse cultures and really boundless potential, if we think about it. But it stands at the precipice of a big change. As we look ahead, the horizon presents both challenges, but also a lot of opportunities for us. The city's heartbeat is kind of growing stronger and faster with an influx of people, which I think is a great thing for our city. It's also got burgeoning job markets and expanding horizons. This growth, while it's promising, it also brings a lot of daunting tasks to ensuring that Auckland remains the livable city that most of us cherish. So if we want, take a minute and imagine a future where our children and their children are walking the same streets that we walk today, and ask yourselves, do they experience the same quality of life? Do they have the same joys? Do they have the same comforts that we have right now? And to ensure that this happens, we have to transition or transcend from our current approach, which often feels like we're perennially fighting fires, jumping from one crisis to another. We need, in this hour, not to use reactive measures, but proactive, visionary planning. Yeah, we have a plethora of policies, and we have documents, and we have guidelines, and they offer us frameworks and suggest pathways, and they provide us some direction. Yet, amidst the sea of paperwork, there's a glaring void, and that is a cohesive, overarching vision. So let's pause and introspect. Who are we, and think about these questions, who are we as Aucklanders? What is our legacy for the city? What do we envision as our city in the future? The path ahead might seem nebulous now, but therein lies our big opportunity, the opportunities that Tiffany talked about, the opportunities that Tim talked about. Auckland's destiny is malleable, and it's waiting for us to shape it. The canvas is vast, and it's high time that we start to paint it with our vision. We don't have to do this blindly. We can pull inspiration from a lot of places. In fact, cities around the world seek inspiration from pioneers who have transformed urban landscapes, enhancing quality of life for their residents. One such shining example is the city of Copenhagen. Many of us have heard that. We've already heard a reference to it now. It's a city that's become synonymous with sustainable urban living and has become a beacon for environmental consciousness. When we talk about the power of vision bringing monumental change, Copenhagen stands out. The change isn't just about infrastructure or policies. It's about impacting people's everyday lives, elevating quality of the city, and championing the betterment of environment, be that the nature, climate, or the broader ecosystem. Today, Copenhagen proudly wears the crown of the world's premier cycling city, one of the city world's premier cycling cities. But its accolades don't stop there. The city boasts efficient public transportation system, and contrary to many urban centers, it remains a pleasant place for motorists. The harmonious coexistence of different modes of transportation is no accident. It's a deliberate result of visionary planning. Rewind a few decades in Copenhagen streets, as you can see in the image here, mirror a lot of what the rest of the world has been experiencing. Like countless cities globally, cars were the king of the road. The hum of engines drowned out the sound of bicycle bells. Safe pathways for cyclists and for pedestrians were scarce. And public transport, constantly battling traffic congestion, was both inefficient and undesirable for the masses. However, the winds of change began to blow when an idea took root. Copenhagen's history has always been intertwined with cycling. Before the automobile's era's dominance, bicycles were the heartbeat of the city. Recognizing this, city leaders, driven by a combination of nostalgia and forward thinking, decided to rekindle Copenhagen's love affair with bicycles. This wasn't a solitary effort. A vocal and passionate public backed them, demanding the return of the city's cycling routes. The transformation of Copenhagen wasn't an overnight phenomenon. It was a journey, one that required a clear vision, unwavering commitment, and consistent efforts. The city's metamorphosis began truly in around 2005, so actually not as long ago as we think, when key figures, including the Lord Mayor, and I won't butcher the name, you can read from there, and the city's bicycle mayor, which is an unofficial name, its more official title was technical and environmental mayor, but that's much less exciting than bike mayor. They championed the cause of cycling. Their dedication to the vision was evident in their actions. They didn't just make promises. They backed them up with real plans, real visions. They paid for studies that showed the importance of bike cycling, like the 2006 pivotal study that showed that a kilometer of cycle track built on a busy road increased cycling by 20% and decreased car traffic by 10%. They used data like this to drive forward their vision for the city. 2007 also marked another significant milestone for Copenhagen: the announcement that the city would host the UN's 2009 International Climate Conference propelled Copenhagen onto the global stage. Seizing this opportunity, the city shaped its vision, sharpened its vision even more, aspiring to emerge as Europe's environmental capital. Ambitious goals were set to achieve complete carbon neutrality by 2025 and to be recognized as the world's cycling capital. The Copenhagen we see today, there you go, same place, a few years forward. The Copenhagen we see today is a testament to the power of vision, leadership, and collective effort. The city leaders not only crafted a vision that they believed in, they championed it. They worked tirelessly to realize it. The result is a city that stands as a global model for sustainable urban living. But Copenhagen isn't alone in its transformation. Another city, Amsterdam, with its iconic canals and rich cultural tapestry, stands as a testament to the transformative power of vision as well. A few decades before Copenhagen embarked on its journey of transformation, Amsterdam faced its own set of challenges. In the 1950s and 1960s, much like its Western counterparts, it was grappling with the rapid rise of automobiles. The city's landscape underwent drastic change. Once bustling neighborhoods where communities thrived and children played in the city and played in the streets were dissected and overshadowed by large highways that were expanded to meet the needs of automobiles. Roads were broadened, and the city became a frenzy of automotive activity. Cycling, which had once been the pride and joy of Amsterdam, was relegated to the sidelines. The consequences of this shift were not limited to the city's aesthetics. The dominance of the car brought one grim reality, and that is, by 1971, the Netherlands witnessed 3,300 traffic deaths in a single year. In a country at the time of a population of about 13 million people, that was 25 car deaths per 100,000 people. 400 of those deaths were children alone. This brought about a rise of community activism and outrage. The protests erupted across the city with Stop Kindermut, which is essentially stop child murder. It became a rallying cry for people across the city and across the country. A few years later, it culminated in the formation of the Dutch Cyclist Union, and together, these citizen-led initiatives crafted a vision for a safer, more cycle-friendly Amsterdam, a vision that extended to other Dutch cities as well. These are some images of the protests that took place over the years. So fast forward today, and Amsterdam and Copenhagen proudly wear the title of the world's premier cycling capitals. Their journeys through, though distinct in their genesis, one the top down and the other from the bottom up, have reshaped urban transportation and land use. These movements, born out of vision and determination, have not only transformed their respective cities, but they've also inspired many other nations. So what does this have to do with Auckland? Auckland, which many would argue is the sprawling jewel of New Zealand, stands at a pivotal juncture in its history. As we gaze into the future, the roadmap to 2050 is dotted with policies, commitments, and aspiration. We've actually laid a lot of the groundwork and policy with policies and commitments and aspirations that will take us to where we need to be in 2050. We've pledged we've pledged as a country to reduce traffic fatalities. We have an emissions reduction plan at the national level that reduces emissions by this timeline. We've aligned ourselves with these global initiatives. We set our sights on introducing cleaner vehicles and more active modes and more public transportation. The city of Auckland itself has many plans in place: the Unitary Plan, regional land use and transportation plans, the TERP, all envision greener, more sustainable Auckland. They advocate for slashing transportation emissions, bolstering public transport, and promoting active modes. These documents are the scaffolding upon which we can construct our future. However, while these policies are crucial, but they're only a skeleton of our evolution. The tales of transformation of Copenhagen and Amsterdam serve as beacons of inspiration for us. They are important in seeing how other cities can chart a path to a greener future, to a more sustainable future, to a future that they want. So to the leaders present here today, I'd pose a challenge. Will you be the torchbearers of Auckland's vision? Will you guide our city and its people towards a brighter, more sustainable future? Much like the stalwarts of Copenhagen did, and to the wider community, the rest of us, the heart and the soul of Auckland, I extend an invitation. Will you participate in crafting this vision? Will you champion it with the same fervor as the parents and children of Amsterdam who rallied for a safer and more inclusive city? The lessons from Copenhagen and Amsterdam are clear. Vision, whether stemming from the top echelons of leadership or the grassroots level of citizenry, has the power to transform. Auckland has the potential and the resources and the will if we give it the space and the time. But to truly realize those aspirations, we must unite and collaborate and coalesce around this shared vision. Thank you.